I've gotten very, after years of being an institutional player, I've gotten very, I've lost interest in it as much, because it feels like no matter how high the idealism is that brings it together, it very quickly degenerates into kind of third chakra power, ego, social structures, and protecting oneself and so on. And the without either a teacher or some formula for overriding that, some real contract to, like satsang or sangha, some form to override that, it ends up where everybody protects their space. And I've been in a lot of social structures now, and I'm getting to the point where I really say no more than I say yes to being part of things. Because I realize that we aren't really ready to be part of something without a lot of consciousness. I mean, I'm in study groups, I'm in wisdom groups, they call them, you know, groups of extraordinary people in America that come together. Once every 6 months, we have a group called the No Name Group. We come together for 3 days. But the willingness of that group to really work on themselves in order to be capable of having a few minutes of consciousness together is not great. And I realize that isn't the license. I don't have the license to say you're all a bunch of lazy slobs. You know, you get to it.
Yeah, well, I was initiated to Lakota water bearer at some time, but anyway, there was a big party and they needed to do a ritual and there was no one there, so I got the lowest grade as a Lakota and dressed up at. And I felt like a chief, and I was a chief of the day. And then I learned that, you know, the main task of a chief is, of a leader is not to lead, it's a leading, not leading.
Exactly.
Serving.
Exactly.
I got the idea of a war chief who's dressed up.
Yeah.
Big guy. And there's the peace chief who lives at the end of the village and he's the poorest guy in town.
Yeah.
He can do some
nice
rituals.
Exactly right.
And he serves.
Yes.
He's the one who really takes.
Yeah.
He's the heart of the society.
Yeah.
Could we teach people to do that, to become traditional leaders in a way that maybe kings were brought up, good kings were brought up in an attitude of service?
Can you shift the culture from third to fourth chakra, from the power of the separate individual to a role within the collective? And that role can be a very humble role. It's very tricky when you've juiced up a certain kind of worldly power so much. And you play it here with, you know, who's on stage and who isn't on stage and all of that. It's very hard.
Well, there were structures in the past, like kings in England. They got a job for 3 years and then they were killed and dumped in the bars. That was the idea. You could become the leader, but...
But those leaders weren't peace leaders. The English kings were not peace leaders, come on.
One time I said, for politicians, I would only like people who are HIV positive.
Yeah.
Do you think that would change the world?
I think it is interesting. I think it definitely takes them out of a very narrow dimension of reality. And because I work so much in the HIV positive world, I would say that it has changed the subcultures in which it has entered very, very dramatically. The gay community, not the needle users so much because they're living in another reality a little more, but certainly the gay community has developed a tremendously deep compassion from that.
And a new
sense of perspective that gives. I think Tim's getting that perspective now as he approaches death. Yeah, I would love that. I mean, I don't want to kill off all of them. Well, I'm not sure about that, but.
Well, then, it comes.
It comes anyway.
It comes anyway, so we better.
And so one of the things I'm going to be interviewing people at the Gorbachev meeting. I'm having a room like this and interviewing them about their personal future. Like, what do they do with their age now? Like, what does Margaret Thatcher do as she gets older and older? It's interesting. Do they think about now transitioning from worldly power into another kind of leadership or another kind of participation?
Yesterday there was a woman who said she just turned 50. And she said, I had my birthday party last weekend. I had to think hard and deep about who am I going to invite on my 50th birthday? Ex-lovers, lovers, friends, business associates, what kind of people. I think to ask that question of someone who turned 70 or 80 years
old. Sure, exactly.
Who would you like to have at your birthday
party? Socrates. Heraclitus. Krishna.
Yes.
Buddha.
You would be on your knees all the time, wouldn't you?
No, no. They're just the mishpacha. They're just the family. You just hang out together.
But if you had a choice of a birthday party in this life, who would you invite?
See, my predicament is that the kind of consciousness I work with is making the major experiment in my life of my heart, the one of seeing the beloved in all forms.
Say that. You pick 15 people on the street, and that would be it.
It's tricky. It's very tricky. Because people think that because some of them are around me more than others, that they're my special friends. And I don't have any special friends. And I don't... It's a very hard thing to communicate to people. They don't understand that, because they just assume...
Monks, too.
The time and space are measures of specialness. And to me, they're measures of function, not of specialness.
I agree. That's I have the center in Amsterdam, and once in a while people walk in, and then we put over the door, "You are welcome. We are all one." Or, "You are not alone. We are all one." And I found that the people that walk in are amazing. Sufi masters, just people off the street that turn out. Maybe they had a reason to come, or whatever, but it's amazing. And the musicians that come on. So people ask me, "Do you have a program? Do you have an idea?" We don't have an idea. It will happen. We're open to whatever comes, and that's amazing.
But you see how delicate that is from an economic position, to keep it stable.
People say you're crazy. Yeah. I don't think it's crazy, because...
But it's a different kind of a social structure. It's an open, permeable social structure. And that one is not an efficient social structure. And the cost of efficiency has been incredibly high in our society.
There was the old idea of a caravanserai. I mean, through the desert you had roads, and then across each other, whatever, and there was the caravan. You had to be there, you had to stay for 3 days, no longer. You were a guest for a certain period of time.
Yeah.
And you meet. And it's like, in life, we have those places where we meet, and it's inevitable that we have a cup of coffee and we do something. I would like to have a place in cyberspace where people come
That's very nice.
And do this.